My name is Moshe Avital. It was changed to Avital. My previous last name was Doft, D-O-F-T. I was born in 1928 in a town called Bilke in eastern Czechoslovakia.
Who were your mother and father?
My father was Rabbi Joshua Doft, and my mother was Pearl Lipschitz Doft.
Your father was a rabbi?
He was a shochet and a chazan of the town.
You had siblings?
Yes, we were 11 children.
11.
I was the youngest. 6 brothers and 5 sisters.
What was your life like as a child?
Very happy. Even though it was a hard life, but we were very happy. The town of Bilke was a beautiful area, and it was blessed with fruit and water and trees, and the air was beautiful. I attended 2 different schools. I attended cheder from the age of 3 and a half. And then at the age of 6, I started to go to Czech public school. And I had a long day, because at 5 o'clock in the morning, we got up to go to cheder. We studied until eight o'clock. At 8, we left to go to the public school. And we studied there until 3:30 in the afternoon. After that, I went by home, grabbed something to eat, and went back to cheder until 8 o'clock in the evening. Came home, did homework for the public school, not for the Hebrew school, and that was my day.
As the youngest child of 11, very often the youngest child is, in some way, the darling. Were you the darling?
Yes, I was. As a matter of fact, until this day, I am very thankful to all my brothers and sisters, because each one wanted to teach me something. And I accumulated a great deal of knowledge from them. So I'm very grateful to them.
It was a good relationship you had with your siblings.
Very good relationship.
What were your parents like in terms of tone? Hard, soft, what were they like?
My father was a very soft-speaking person. Also, he was not very strict. My mother was more a disciplinarian. Of course, she had to be, because we were 13 nefashot, 13 souls in the family. But she was a very fine person. She had many good attributes.
Did either of your parents have a sense of humor?
Yeah, my father used to tell from time to time jokes, but, you know, jokes that had to do with learning.
Was there laughter in your home?
Oh, yes. Especially during Shabbatot and holidays, the Zmirot, and they were unusual.
What was the Jewish character of your home growing up?
It was an Orthodox home, although leaning towards the modern, because my brothers and sisters, they went to public high school, and they studied Czech literature and languages, and especially my brothers used to read the Jewish press, which came from Poland. The Hind and the Moment, these were very wonderful papers that spoke about what's going on in the entire Jewish world. And the youth really got a great deal out of it.
So your parents encouraged general secular learning?
Yes. But also, Jewish learning was very important. My older brothers, when they, after their bar mitzvah, they went to yeshivot in Slovakia, the greater yeshivot, where they studied for years, 5 years, 6 years, and they accumulated a great deal of knowledge.
And then what did they do?
Some of them became teachers in our hometown. One brother became a Zionist. And it's interesting that for 5 years he studied at the yeshiva in Slovakia. And my father used to write to the Rosh Yeshiva asking how he is doing. He always got good reports. That year he wrote again to the Rosh Yeshiva and he asked him, how's my son Shmuel Tzvi doing? He said, he is not here. He was surprised to hear that. And he found out that instead of going to the yeshiva, he went to Hakshara. That was a preparation for Aliyah to Israel. There was like a kibbutz where they learned farming and all kinds of things. And my father was very angry. He called him back. And my brother said to him, I am a Zionist, and I see what's going to happen because there's a lot of anti-Semitism. Therefore, I'm going to go to Israel.
What did your father say?
He didn't want him to go, and my mother didn't want him either, because my mother felt, where are you going to go, to a desolate country, and the Arabs are killing Jews, and they begged them not to. Also, there was a certain atmosphere that the religious leadership created in Czechoslovakia, not only Czechoslovakia, like the Satmar and the Munkacs and those, that they were anti-Zionists. So they spoke against it. So my father felt awkward to have a son that is a Zionist and is going to Israel.
Did you feel you grew up in a Zionist-oriented home, or really not?
The Zionism I got when I joined Bnei Akiva. In our hometown in Bilka, there were all the Zionist movements, youth organizations. There was Beitar, there was Poalei Agudat Yisrael, there was Mizrahi, Bnei Akiva, Hashomer HaTzair, you name it. And everybody chose whatever they wanted to do. And of course, since we came from a religious home, my brothers and I were in Bnei Akiva. And that's where I learned about Zionism. I learned songs. We read the press from Israel, and we celebrated various occasions. So that's where I got that feeling about being Zionist. Mm-hmm.
Of course, at that time it was called Palestine.
Yes.
But it still was Eretz Yisrael.
Oh, yes, especially when we learned in Cheder about the Ma'arat HaMachpelah and about the Harabayit and the Kever Rachel and all these things that made it alive for us.
So you're living a good life.
Yes.
And then the cloud begins to come.
Right.
Did your father or mother see it coming? Did you see it coming?
I didn't, because when Czechoslovakia was torn apart, I was only 10 years old. So, I mean, I heard about it, and I used to like to, in the yard of the synagogue, of the main synagogue, the Jews used to stand outside between Mincha and Ma'ariv and talk politics. So I used to listen, and that's where I got my news. But I myself only knew that what's going on, but we thought that maybe they'll never come to our area. I don't know exactly what my father knew or what he felt, but the trouble started when the Hungarians occupied the Carpathians. That's when the trouble started.
And what does it mean to you personally that the trouble started?
I'll tell you right away. My father, Alav Shalom, was born in Poland. When he was 5 years old, his family moved to the Carpathians. And when the Hungarians came in, the first thing they did, they demanded that all the people should prove their citizenship. My father never asked for Czech citizenship because the Czechs were liberal people. They never bothered anybody to have their citizenship. So those that could not get their citizenship, they were deported already in 1940 to Kamenets Podolsk. That's in the Ukraine. My father went into hiding and us, the entire family, my mother and us 11 children, changed our name from Doft to Lipschitz because we were born in Czechoslovakia and we were able to prove that we are citizens of the area. And there were 20,000 Jews from the Carpathians that were deported to Kamenets Podolsk, and they were all massacred on August 28, 1941, by the Ukrainians, the Einsatzgruppen from the Germans and the Hungarians. One of my uncles, a brother of my father, and his entire family of eight were deported there, and that's where they were annihilated. So that's where the trouble started.
What year is this?
This was 1941. Also, the Hungarians conscripted all the males, 18 to 50, to what they called Munko Tabor, to labor battalions. And instead of them giving them guns, they gave them shovels. And they sent them to the Ukraine, to the Russian front, to build all kinds of fortifications, roads, and airfields. Two of my brothers were sent to these battalions, and both of them perished there.
Before your father goes into hiding,
yes,
do you think he felt as if he were a Czechoslovakian citizen, whether he had the papers or not? What was the self-identity that your parents had? Were they in some way Czechs, or were they simply Jews living in Czechoslovakia?
Well, they were Czechs because all our lives, we paid taxes, we never were asked for any documents or anything like that. I felt all the time like a Czech, and I was a patriot, as a matter of fact. I loved Masaryk, the president of Czechoslovakia. I used to sing the songs. I was very, very much in love with Czechoslovakia.
Does your father actually live somewhere away from you during this period of time?
No, he wasn't away, but he was very careful. Every time there were rumors they're going to check or something, he was hiding.
What happens next?
There were all kinds of decrees that the Hungarians decreed against the Jews. They took away all the properties. Jews were not allowed to have any stores. All the professionals were fired. Doctors, lawyers, teachers, professors, all these people lost their jobs. And especially when they took away all the men, 18 to 50, that was a terrible thing because the families could not make a living. And then there came news that this one was killed or this one died in the labor camps and so on. So that was a terrible thing. Mm-hmm. I know that many people say that the Hungarians weren't so bad that until the last minute, but it's not true. The truth is that from the first moment on, they were fascists. Whenever a policeman was walking on the street, the Jews were running for hiding because they were terrible.
What are you feeling personally during this period of time? It sounds frightening. Were you frightened?
I was frightened, and also I despised them. I despised the Hungarians very much, I must be honest. And they also mobilized the youth. They called it Levente. Every boy from age of 12 until 18 had to do some work in the town. I remember the first time that we were taken to the large church to clear away the snow. Now, for us, it was a terrible thing because no Jewish boy ever went into the yard of the church because we were told not to. And here we were there and having to shovel snow and other kinds of work that we had to do. It was a daily struggle. First of all, there was rationing. There was a shortage in food. I remember I used to go standing in line at the bakery in order to get a loaf of bread for the family. Used to get up 4 o'clock in the morning in order to be like the earlier ones in line. Whenever we saw that a wagon with flour arrived to some grocery store, I ran immediately to stand there and line up in order to get there. For instance, my father was a big cigarette smoker. There were no cigarettes. Once in a while, they gave out some rationing. I used to run in order to get, because my bigger brothers weren't home, so I was the one who ran around to get these things. So this was the life. We had to adjust to it, but it was impossible. Mm-hmm. We were constantly in danger.
Were you hungry?
Sometimes, yes, but my mother was a terrific housekeeper and cook and baker. She made things out of nothing. We also had, in the back of our house, we had a field that we planted all kinds of things, all kinds of vegetables and corn, and we had fruit trees and so on. So that nourished us.
What about school? You were going to both the secular school and the cheder. What happened in each of them?
Okay, the Ukrainians, the Ruthenians, had their own public school system under the Czechs even, because the Czechs gave autonomy to all these minorities, like the Jews were able to have their own schools and so on. So when the Hungarians came in, they established the Hungarian public school, and they gave a choice. Whoever wanted could go to the Hungarian school, or to the Ruthenian. I didn't know Hungarian, and so were many of the Jewish kids, because we went to the Czech public school. We switched over to the Ruthenian one. So I went to the Ruthenian public school. But they were very anti-Semitic. I had pears, and I kept them under my ears. And I was sitting in school with a friend of mine also, his name was Moshe Brown. And two Gentile boys were sitting in the back of us, in the back of our bench. And they started to pull my pears and the same thing with Moshe. When we went out for recess, we beat them up. I couldn't stand a thing like this. So they ran to the teacher, and they were crying and telling him that these Jews beat me up. The teacher called us. He put us in front of the class, and he scolded us, and he said that he is calling our parents. He sent somebody to call my father. My father came, and without asking any question, my father gave me two smacks in front of the class. And he apologized to the teacher and he left. When I came home, I was crying and I said to my father, I was protecting Jewish honor and you come and you hit me in front of the goyim there, I said. He said, what can we do? We are in Golus. We are in the diaspora. And we have to be careful what we do. And I didn't want to go back to school anymore. For a month, I didn't go. But there was a rule. If you didn't go to school, the parents went to jail. So I had to go back. But only for a short time, because then the Jews were not allowed to go anymore to school.
At one point, you had Czech friends in school.
Yes.
Do they ever turn on you?
No. No. The Czech teachers were wonderful.
What happens next?
Well, as time progressed, we heard all kinds of rumors that Jews are being taken to various places, but we didn't know that there were death camps or anything like that. And then on Pesach, 1944, the last day of Pesach, we were informed that tomorrow, meaning the day after Pesach, we are going to leave our homes and we are going to be taken to a place where we will be secure, and that we are allowed to take only 25 pounds per person. So that night, everybody was packing feverishly.
You have to decide what 25 pounds you're going to take?
Yes.
What did you take?
Well, I took tefillin, I took a siddur, I took a Bible, and took some clothing. And then also, as a family, we took some food, I mean durable food, some cans, maybe cooked hard-boiled eggs. Since it was Pesach, we broke some of the matzahs into pieces in order to take with us. And that's what we did. We didn't know a thing what was going to happen. And the only thing that I heard the older people saying, you know, there were bad times before. We are going to live through this too. Hashem will help us, you know. In the morning, the Hungarian police came to our house and they told us to leave everything, and they sealed up the house and they told us to go to the yard of the synagogue, which was not far from us. When we came there, there were all the people from the town there, and there were guards all around us with guns and bayonets. And they had a list of all the Jews of Vilka. The president of the community, the Rosh HaKahal, was asked a long time ago to give them a list of all the Jewish inhabitants, and he had no choice, he had to give them. And from this list, they called out the names, and then we started to march to the train station. As we were marching down the road, it was quite a distance from the shul to the train station, the Gentiles were standing on both sides of the road, and you could see how happy they were, that they're getting rid of the Jews, and they'll be able to pillage the Jewish homes. And the march took a long time because the men were not with us, the able-bodied men. They were all in the Munko Tabor, in the labor camps. And when we arrived at the train station, there was a boxcar train waiting for us. I was with my father, my mother, five sisters. Two of my sisters were married and had six children, and one brother who was 2.5 years older than me. And we were all pushed into this boxcar with our little bundles.
What are you thinking?
We were crying. We were crying because we didn't know where they are taking us. And it was very crowded. And walking down the street, the last time of my hometown, I was looking and seeing all the Jewish houses and all the beautiful things that I lived all these 14 years. And I was thinking of Yetziat Mitzrayim, of the exodus from Egypt. But I said to myself, that exodus was a happy thing. They were leaving to go to the land of Israel. Here we are going, we don't know where we are going.
You were crying?
Yes.
Was your mother crying?
Everybody was crying.
You're sealed in the boxcar?
Yeah.
How long are you in the boxcar?
48 hours.
Standing?
Standing, because there was no room to sit down. It was crowded with about 100 people in a boxcar.
You're very cramped.
Yes.
Was there enough water?
The water almost ended, yeah.
So at some point there's no water?
No.
And how do people go to the bathroom here?
Well, you know, at first people are ashamed.
Yes.
To in front of, but they had no choice. So there were people standing with their backs in order to cover. And that's what we did. But at the same time, you can be amazed what a human being can go through. It depends how strong you are in your personality, in your feelings, in your hopes. That's very important.
What were you hoping?
I was hoping that the miracle will happen and we'll go back.
All of your family survived the boxcar?
Yes. We arrived in this ghetto, Berehovo. There used to be a brick factory. And they placed us in these structures. There were no walls. There were only poles supporting the roof because bricks were placed in there. There were no doors, no windows, nothing. There were no beds, nothing. And ghetto management gave out to each family a certain section of the barrack there on both sides of this structure according to the number of people in the family. And you know, human beings are, they try to help each other. So what we did was we went out in the fields and tried to collect a few bricks to try maybe to build a little bit of a wall. And some took ropes, if they found ropes or maybe they took with them, and they hung up some blankets in order to divide between family and family in order to have some privacy. And then at night, we laid down the bedding on the floor, and that's where we slept.
How many of there were you and your family now?
Well, we were my parents, my brother Yosef, and I, that's four. My five sisters, that's nine, and the six
children. And what do you think is going to happen to you?
We don't know.
What do you do during the day?
During the day, we had to work.
At what?
All kinds of things in the kitchen. Some people were taken into Berehovo, into the city, in order to work there. All kinds of chores.
What do you do?
I didn't do anything.
Because?
Because the children were not working.
So what did you do all day?
Well, we're trying to help out my mother to prepare some food or bring some water or whatever.
And what are you feeling in the ghetto?
I feel very angry. Mm-hmm. Very angry. And I don't know why we are put in such a position. We haven't done anything. And also, I was wondering why God allows a thing like this. That was on my mind constantly.
Did you ask your parents why?
No, I didn't ask, because the custom was not such to ask questions like these.
But you asked yourself?
Yes.
Do you think your parents asked in their private moments?
I'm almost sure they did.
Were there any people around you who voiced the question out loud?
No, but people went around crying and yelling. There was one woman that was going around saying, "Escape, go away, terrible things will happen." And people were quite against Don, that they were saying that she is spreading rumors for no reason. You know, there were two different kinds of opinions, that you have to keep quiet and not arouse any attention or whatever.
Were people nice to each other in this setting, or did the sense of, whether it's fear, anxiety, begin to separate people?
In the ghetto, people were still very nice to each other.
Still?
Still. Later on in the camps, that's a different story.
Do you still expect it to end? Are you waiting for it to end and to go home?
We were hoping. I'll tell you, when we were in the wagon on the way to Auschwitz, my father made a statement to the people in the wagon. He said, "If President Roosevelt will find out what's happening, he is going to stop that right away." I mean, that's how far Jews believed in Roosevelt. Mm-hmm. And they thought that, you know, the world doesn't know. Once the world finds out, it will be corrected.
You didn't really know either at the time. When you're in the ghetto, you don't know what's happening to Jews.
No.
In death camps?
No.
How do you think that's possible, that you didn't know, that nobody had told you?
The Germans were very clever. They deceived everybody. Everything was done very secretly and very quick. And so the people didn't have even a chance to find out. And also, the nature of the Jewish people in Europe, or in general, was to be subdued, not to arouse any, to make waves. And they thought, all right, we are in Gaulus, what can you do? You have to suffer, and it'll pass, you know, this kind of a thing. Even the sign in Auschwitz, Arbeit macht frei, is a deceiving sign. Everything they did was deceiving.
How long are you in the ghetto?
In the ghetto, we were 6 weeks.
And then what happens?
Then one day, we were told that they're being moved to a more secure place because the Russians are coming, which was true. The Russians were not far from there. I just want to tell you an interesting thing. There were three boys, 18-year-olds, in our hometown that, while we were still in Bilka, they decided to escape across the border to the Russian side. And they did. They succeeded to cross over, and the Russians caught them, put them on trial, and they claimed that they are spies, put them in one of their gulags, and they gave them 10 years or whatever prison. And they suffered a great deal. In 1948, 3 years after the war, they were moved to another camp. And there, the commandant of the camp was a Jewish man in charge. And he happened to be not religious, but he kept the tradition of the Yahrzeit after his father. And he was looking for Jews for a minyan. So he found out that these three boys are Jewish, and he brought them there, and they had a minyan. And they told him what happened to them. He took them on his jeep, and he took them to the Romanian border, which was not far, and he told them, run. And that's how they were saved.
How do you know this story?
Because when they came back, they told me. One of them lived in Israel. I met him there. He even joined the Irgun in Israel. And the others were in Canada.
Okay.
Yeah.
So after the ghetto, what happens?
A day or two before this order came, they told us to deposit all our valuables. They put baskets in front of these barracks, and everybody had to deposit their watches, their rings, their money, their currency, whatever they had in these places.
And you did?
Everybody did, except me. I was a rebel, except me. What happened was that before we left home, one of my sisters was a seamstress. And I had a cap. She sewed into my cap some money. And when the order came to deposit everything, my father said everybody should give it, you know. And they did. And he told me to do the same thing. And I said no. And I ran out of the barrack. And I went into the field. And I was hiding there until the thing was over. When I came back for another few days, we were able to buy some food on the black market from what I had in my head. So that was before we were leaving. Everything had to be deposited.
And what were people thinking when they're told, deposit everything you have? By the way, you left your home.
Yes.
With very little to begin with.
Yeah, but people did take money. They did take jewelry with them. I mean, they didn't take heavy things.
What they could wear.
What they can wear or what they can carry in their pocket.
And what are you thinking when they say, okay, everything valuable goes into this pot? What are you thinking?
Well, we knew that because they warned, those that will not do it will be shot. So people were afraid. Mm-hmm. When you're under the gun, you do a lot of things which usually you don't.
Then you put on boxcars again.
Yes.
How many hours?
5 days.
5 days.
And in the boxcar, they put two containers. One container with water and one container for human needs. Mm. And 100 people were pushed into the boxcar. And the doors closed. And the train was going and stopping and going and stopping. And every boxcar has on top a little opening with barbed wire secured. The boxcar is very high. So there were some people in the boxcar that stood on the shoulders of somebody. And every time the train stopped, they looked out through the wind, through this little opening. And they saw that we arrived in Košice, which was on the border between the Carpathians and Slovakia. After that, the doors opened up, and two high-ranking officers, one Hungarian and one SS officer, with a loudspeaker, announced, "From this moment on, you are under the command of the German army." And the doors slammed shut, and the train started moving. And this went on day after day, until again they looked out when the train stopped, and they see it says Krakow, which was in Poland. So we knew that we are already in Poland, but we didn't know where they are taking us. In the meantime, the water was all used up. The other basket was overflowing. People were dying from hunger, from stench, from all this that went on there. And then, on the fifth day, the train stopped, and they look out the window, and they see a name that they never heard of. And they ask around, have anybody ever heard the name Auschwitz? Of course, nobody heard.
People died in that boxcar.
Oh, yes.
Did your whole family that was in the boxcar survive?
Yes.
They've brought you Auschwitz. What happens next?
When we arrived in Auschwitz, the door suddenly opened up, And there were screams in German. Raus, raus, out, out, schnell, schnell, fast, fast, with clubs and with their guns. And now the boxcar is very high. There were no steps, and we had to get off. So the young people, I mean, a boy like me could jump off, although I was hungry and tired. But the elderly man with babies and all that, so they clubbed everybody, whoever couldn't get off, and they yelled that we should leave the bundles on the platform or in the boxcar. And also, they announced that women and children on one side and men on the other side. And that was the last time I saw my mother, my five sisters, and their six children. And my father and my brother Yosef and I were sent now to the right, to this side. And then the selection started. This officer, Mengele.
Was it Mengele?
It was Mengele. He motioned to my father to go to the left. Now, at that time, we didn't know what it meant, left or right. My brother Yosef, who was 17 and a half, he motioned to go to the right. When I stood in front of him, he hesitated for a moment what to do with me. And then finally, he motioned for me to go to the right with my brother. Now, I saw a number of my friends from my hometown, my age, who were sent to the left. And I don't know what happened. I always say it must have been Schutavot, the merits of my ancestors, that I was sent to this side. But that meant only living for the moment.
And you didn't know it when you went to the right?
No, I didn't know what it meant.
And then what happens to you when you go to the right?
Then they told us to line up, and they marched us into Auschwitz. When we marched in there, there was a huge barrack, and they told us to get undressed, to take off all our clothing and our shoes and throw them on the piles that there were already piles there.
What are you thinking now?
You were acting like a robot. You didn't have time to, because they were constantly hitting you and clubbing you and yelling at you. This kind of terror that they used doesn't let you even think. And from there, we were taken to the next room.
Naked?
Naked.
What's the weather like?
Well, it was the end of May.
So it isn't cold?
It isn't cold there, but we were very cold in the wagons when we were traveling.
In the boxcar?
Yes, because at night it was very cold. And during the day it was very hot.
So they tell you, so you're now naked?
Naked, and we go into the next room, and there are barbers, prisoners who have been there from before, and they shave us from head to toe. And then they take us into the next.
Do they speak to you?
No.
This is done really in silence.
Everything is in silence. The prisoners that are doing the work, they don't talk.
And do you talk with anybody else at the time?
No, because there were SS men in there, and they wouldn't let anybody talk.
When you think back on it, it is beyond comprehension, is it not?
It sure is. It sure is.
You're a robot. All your hair is shaved off. Then
yes.
What?
They take us into the next room. There was a huge swimming pool there. And they told us to immerse ourselves. That was disinfectant. It had a horrible odor. And then they take us into the next room. There were showers. We showered. And then finally, in the last room, they were standing again prisoners with prisoner uniforms. And they were throwing at us uniforms for us. They threw at me a huge uniform, which I couldn't wear because it was falling off me. I was lucky that near me was standing a tall, husky fellow, And we exchanged, because he got a small one and I got a big one. So that's how we were able to wear it. And then they lined us up and they took us inside Auschwitz into a barrack. When we came into the barrack, on both sides of the walls, there were like shelves, three stories high, from one end of the barrack until the other, 1,000 people into this barrack. And soon after that, an SS officer came in and he gave us a pep talk. And he says, "You are in the concentration camp Auschwitz. Remember this, it's not a recuperation center. Arbeit macht frei. Here you must work. If not, you go straight to the crematorium."
Did he use those words?
Yes. "Your choice is either work or crematorium." That's what he said, and he walked out. My brother and I were looking at each other. We didn't recognize each other because we lost our Jewish looks. We were very tired. You are so tired that you cannot think. And they gave out for each one. There was each compartment. There were 8 people that had to lie down. There were no mattresses, no sheets, no blankets, no pillows, nothing. Just lying on the boards.
8?
8 to a compartment. It was so crowded.
And you do?
And we do.
Are you with your brother?
I am with my brother. We try to make sure that we always are together, both in the same barrack. And also, there was twice a day, there was appel, which means roll call. And everybody had to line up in rows of 5. The shorter people in front and the taller ones in the back so they can see all the faces. And we always lined up on the same line because we heard already from other people that sometimes people are separated. And at this appel in the morning, they gave us breakfast, which consisted of a bowl of black coffee for every 5 prisoners. So the first one took and drank. He had to give it to the second, third, fourth, and fifth. By the time it got to the 4th or 5th, there was nothing left because everybody was so hungry that they wanted to drink more. And that created fights among the prisoners. And they did it purposely in order to make bad blood.
At any point here, do you have the ability to say, "I understand what's happening. This is hell, and you just either... you just cry forever"?
You cried so much that after a while you stopped crying. You had no more tears. I mean, not all the time, but there were times that you just couldn't cry. I mean, you saw people dying all the time, and it's one of these things that you say, "All right, I'll probably be the next."
Did you ever hope to die?
The only time that I wished I would die was during the death march.
We'll get to that.
Yeah.
Did you ever go and pray?
Yes, I did.
With the group?
Yeah.
How often?
Once in a while, whenever it was possible, because most of the time we were very busy.
Do you understand what's happened now to your father who went to the left?
A few days later, I found out. And I didn't know what happened to my mother and the sisters and the children.
You could imagine.
Yes.
So what do you do during the day?
We work.
Where?
There was construction. There was cleaning of the camp. There were loading and unloading at the train station. All kinds of things.
Are you strong enough to do this at this point in time?
I'll tell you, I was pretty strong. My mother, Alea Shalom, fed me well. Maybe that's one of the reasons I survived, because I really was very well built.
How about your brother?
Also.
At one point now, you're told to leave Auschwitz.
We weren't told. We were standing at the roll call, and they say, above face, the whole unit is taken to the train station. Just like that. You come to the train station, they push in 100 people in a wagon, and the train goes. We don't know where. And we arrived in Plaszów. When we arrived in Plaszów, we lined up on the Appellplatz, on the roll call area. And there were SS men sitting in front of tables. And each one walked over to this SS man, and they asked, what is your profession? Now, I was a kid, I was a student, so I said, I was a student. So they write me down for hard labor. My brother learned from my sister at home to sew on a sewing machine. So he said that he is a tailor. And in Plaszów, they had tailor shops that made uniforms for the German army. So they put him down as a tailor. So the next morning, I went, marched out 8 kilometers to Krakow train station to load and unload heavy equipment for the German army that was sent to the Eastern Front. And my brother was working in the tailor shop. But we slept in the same barrack, one near another. In the evening, after 12 hours, when I came back, I used to cry on his shoulders, telling him how hard I'm working and how hungry I am. And, you know, he felt for me and he tried to encourage me and whatever. And this went on all the time. 4 months we were in Plaszów and we were going on doing this work. I mean, a lot of people died. And this beast, the commandant, who had the villa on top of the mountain, who used to shoot down in the camp whenever he saw people standing that they didn't run or something. It was just a horrible place. And also the Polish Jews, there were about 50,000 Polish Jews in this camp, and only 1,000 of us from Czechoslovakia and from Hungary that were brought there. They resented that we came late. They used to say to us, you had it good. You went, you had to food and you went to the cinema and you did this and that, and we slaved here. I mean, it didn't make any sense, but that's what it was. Especially the Hungarian Jews, they disliked very much because they didn't speak Yiddish. They only spoke Hungarian. A lot of them spoke only Hungarian. But the Carpathian Jews spoke Yiddish. So we were able to converse with them.
You said to me earlier, even in the ghetto, people were nice to each other.
Yeah.
But you said it changed over time.
It changed, right.
What's it like here?
The thing changed, I'll tell you. We received 700 calories a day. The black coffee was the breakfast. For lunch, we got a small bowl of soup, which was supposed to be vegetable soup, but it mostly was dirty water-like. If you found once in a while a piece of carrot or some other vegetable, that was a real treasure. And at supper time, when we came back from work, they gave us a slice of bread with either margarine or jam and coffee again. Now, this bread was not the usual bread. The flour was mixed with sawdust. That's what the flour was mixed. But even that bread, if you would have gotten a larger piece, at least the stomach would have felt more full. So there were three different philosophies that people developed of how to eat this bread. One that was taking a crumb and hiding it. Another cut it into three or four pieces for breakfast, lunch, supper, and before he fell asleep. And others ate it at once, the whole thing. Why? Because there were prisoners who attacked you and robbed you from the bread. I always ate it at once. It was secure in your stomach. I mean, you learned, you know, a lot of things, how to behave. You had to outsmart the situation.
These were Jews who would steal from other Jews because they were so hungry.
Yes, yes. And other nationalities too.
Mm-hmm. By the way, I should have asked you, in Auschwitz, was there any Judaism? Did people get together for Shabbat or for Yom Tov in any way?
There were some that took risks and they stood in the corner and they prayed. I remember reading Primo Levi wrote something that when he saw in one of the barracks that was a group of Jews standing and davening there, that he was envying them because they had something to hold on to. And it's a fact that religious Jews had more of an opportunity or something like that to survive because they believed in something. The others gave up very fast.
And how do you describe yourself?
I believed. I believed in God. I believed and I had faith that one day I'm going to be liberated. I didn't want to give in.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.